price you paid.
Thank you for the price you paid.
Bearing all my sin.
Bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came.
Gave amazing grace.
Gave amazing grace.
Thank you for the stars.
Thank you for the stars, Lord. Thank you for
of God. Thank you for the cross.
Thank you for the cross, Lord.
Thank you for the price you paid.
Thank you for the price you paid.
Bearing all my sin, Lord.
Bearing all my sin and shame.
In love you came.
In love you came.
Gave amazing grace.
Now all I know
is your forgiveness.
And your forgiveness.
And
your
embrace.
given to this world. Lord, spare not his son. Deliver him up to be crucified. Everybody say, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Bow your heads with me as we pray. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. We have received fresh revelation of who you are, and still we don't know you. But at least we know you are deserving of our praise this evening. It doesn't matter what burdens we are carrying this evening, we praise the name of God. Thank you for waking us up to see another day. Thank you for taking us through this day. You kept some of us out of the reach of an accident or an incident that would have prevented us from being here this evening. You have been good to us, oh God. And we just give you the praise for just being alive and being well enough to know and to say that God is good.
Amen.
Once again, we have gathered together to hear your voice. We would never tire of hearing your voice. In fact, we might as well get used to it because we have eternity to be hearing that same voice over and over again. And so, Father, fill our hearts with a word that is needed for your people this evening. May it reverberate even when this service would have come to an end. May that still small voice continue to speak to our hearts. We thank you for what you're about to do as you beat back the forces of evil and you dispel darkness. Let light shine in this place here this evening. Let God arise and let all his enemies scatter in the name of Jesus the Christ. Let everyone say
amen.
Amen and amen. You may be seated. Our subject is the silence of the Lamb. Very precious presentation. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to the book of Isaiah, chapter 53. Isaiah, chapter 53. I'm going to read from verse 1. Please follow as I read. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. We were ashamed of him, for he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet in spite of that, and despite that, we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. You're mighty quiet. The chastisement, some people say, of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Come on, somebody say amen. Amen. With his stripes, we are healed. Verse 6 says, all we like sheep have gone astray, and we have turned everyone to his own way. Help me, Jesus. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Here's a text for tonight. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. The silence of the Lamb. I can understand Isaiah's exclamation when he wrote this passage of the Passion of the Christ. As Christ was seen dumb before his shearers, I suspect that Isaiah himself became dumbfounded when he learned that this was going to be his long-awaited Messiah. It is as if he had issued a disclaimer at the beginning of the passage. He was like saying, before you read this, let me tell you, these are not my words. And I found it difficult myself to understand this. So he started the passage by saying, who will believe this report? Who will have accepted this account of the long-awaited Messiah? Not even I myself could understand, because we long for a Messiah who would come as a king. But this does not seem to be a king. Who had believed this report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? This man who was despised and rejected, my Messiah, our deliverer, smitten of God and afflicted. No, something must be wrong with this report. Who hath believed this report? No wonder many today don't believe in Jesus, because they can't believe in what he has done. Who will believe in this Jesus? I have breaking news for you tonight. October 9, 2013. That's Wednesday, this week, in Ohio, Jackson, Ohio. An Ohio school district has agreed to pay five anonymous complainants $3,000 each in damages. And the American Civil Liberties Union, ACLU, and the Freedom from Religion Foundation of Madison, Wisconsin, a combined total of $80,000 in court costs after being sued for keeping an image of Jesus on school property. At issue was a painting of Jesus that had previously been displayed as part of a hall of honor at the Jackson City School District's middle school, alongside images of other famous historical figures. The image had been given to the school district as a gift by the high school High Y Student Club in 1947. Stay with me. Since 1947, this image had been displayed in the school, and it was not a problem. Hung there, however, it was taken down on February 2013. That was when the ACLU and the Freedom from Religion Foundation sued on behalf of two students and three parents, who argued that the painting amounted to an unconstitutional government endorsement of Christianity. Are you with me, church? At the time, the school board responded by returning the picture to the student, which chose to display it at the high school, which district officials said they had the right to do. District Superintendent Phil Howard vowed to fight the lawsuit, telling the school board a lot of things are permissible so long as they are student-led or student-initiated. In other words, the officials immediately had no problem with the picture. However, when the school district's insurance company said it would not reimburse them for costs incurred battling the lawsuit, district officials decided they had to give in. Get this. In April 2013, get this. In April 2013, this year, get this. In April 2013, the district had the image of Jesus removed from public view. But the plaintiffs, it was removed from public view. It was removed from where it was. But the plaintiffs still pressed on with their lawsuit. And you must ask the question, why? Complaining that the picture could still be potentially seen by anyone who entered the art closet where it was stored. Are you hearing me, church? There's something about Jesus that the devil doesn't like. They took it down and put it in a closet, but the plaintiffs were not satisfied. They alleged that to have an image of Jesus anywhere on school property was offensive and unconstitutional. Now the district has agreed to pay $95,000 in settlement. Though this is, for me, both comical and serious at the same time. Because the truth is, we don't even know if that looks like Jesus in the first place. Are you with me, church? It's like you coming to me and telling me I'm going to sue you for putting a picture of yourself, which happened to be my brother. We don't even know if that's the image of Jesus. It's just an image of Jesus. The enemy is even angry with the image. So you better believe he's angry with the person himself. And I always say he has to be angry because Jesus kicked the man out of heaven. Hello, somebody. Jesus got rid of him. I told you once and I told you twice. Jesus had to have given him a hell of a kick because somewhere I read they saw him fall like lightning. It was a hell of a kick. That's why the devil has enough respect for Jesus. That's why he tries to get rid of Jesus out of your life. That's why he wants us to make you stop praying, because he knows he has all authority over you once you don't have Jesus. But when you start to talk to Jesus, I said, when you start to talk to Jesus, the gates of hell shall. Today, many do believe that Jesus existed, but they refuse to accept him as the Son of God. You all know that. They admit that Jesus was a good man, but they tell you he could never be a God man. Well, let me tell you something, church, this might shock you. If they believe he was a good man, they have to accept he was a God man. Well, what do I mean? What do I mean by that? The fact is, Jesus, the good man, said, I am the Son of God. Now, if that's not true, Jesus saying, I am the Son of God, means that Jesus was lying. And if he is a good man, he won't lie. Oh, you don't hear me, church. You don't hear me. Huh? Jesus can't be lying and still be considered a good man. So it's either he's a lunatic, a misguided maniac who doesn't know what he is saying, or he's telling us the truth. Well, I want to declare to you this evening that Jesus cannot lie. There's only one that lies. He is the father of lies, Satan himself. But Jesus has to be everything he said he is. He said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am life. Hello, somebody. Whatever Jesus says to you, he means it. He cannot lie. It's impossible for him to lie. I said it's impossible. Let me tell you how powerful that statement is. Jesus cannot lie, so much so that if this jacket, Jesus comes right now and says that jacket is red, it will become red. Oh, you hear me, church? Are you hear me, church? Eh? Because he called it those things which be not as though they were. So even if it looks blue to you, once Jesus said red, it will be red. He can't lie. And his word will never return unto you void. We have heard it said so many times. Jesus has to be very careful in how he speaks. Lazarus, only you I want.
Because I can't say come forth because everybody will hear my voice. So Lazarus, it's only you I want. That's why tonight he's just calling you. No, he's not calling you and your husband. He is calling you. Hello, somebody. Not you and your daughter or you and your parent. He's calling you. So today, if you hear his voice, that guy powerful. You see yourself sick in bed. Jesus says, no, you're well. Get up. But I'm looking sick. It's not how you look. It's what I say. And once I say it, it will change who you are. Hallelujah. Get up.
He said, search the scriptures, for you will see that they testify of me. Indeed, the scriptures do testify of Jesus. He is the true Noah that will save God's people from the flood of God's wrath. He is Abraham, the friend of God, in whom all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. He is a true Isaac, the promised son. He is a true Jacob who will wrestle all night just to save you. Are you with me, church? He is the true Joseph who was sold out, locked up, but rose again. Joseph was sold out. He was locked up because of Mrs. Potiphar, and then he rose again in the palace. But Jesus was sold for 30 pieces of silver. Then he was locked up in the grave, but he rose again, and God has given him a name which is above all names. He is a true Joseph. He is a true Samson who destroyed more enemies when he died. Samson killed more enemies when he died. That's why the devil had a problem. Should I kill him or should I keep him alive? And he made a mistake of trying to kill him. But Jesus said, you can't kill me. I have to lay down my life. I have to lay down my life. And beloved, when Jesus died, he had a few people following him. But beloved, now are we the sons of God? Hallelujah! Beloved, now are we the sons of God? He is the true David that got rid of Goliath with Goliath's sword. I said he got rid of Goliath with Goliath's sword. You didn't hear what I just said. He got rid of Goliath with Goliath's sword. So Satan had a cross, and Jesus went up on the cross and came down from the cross and left the serpent up there. You see, Jesus got rid of the serpent, even though the serpent used the cross to get rid of Jesus. Are you listening to me, church? He used his own sword. That's why you can't run out of Jesus. You will always run into him. He is whoever he says he is. If he says he's bread, he is bread. If he's light, he is light. If he is water, he is water. Help me, somebody. If he's resurrection, he's resurrection. If he's your provider, he's your provider. If he says I'm protector, he will protect you. Because a man cannot lie. Cannot lie. He is who he says he is. He was not just a man. Jesus was man. He was real man. All of us are becoming. That's why, ladies, the husband you have is giving you trouble. He is still becoming. That's why, husbands, your wives give you plenty problems, because they're becoming. Now, I'm serious. Jesus is man. It can't get a better man than that man called Jesus. He was real man, but he was not just a God. He was God. He was God. And when the two came together, we got Jesus. He was all of God and all of man without having a split personality. One day, angel came to Mary and said, Mary, I need to borrow your womb for 9 months. For what? What for? I don't know how to tell you this, but Mary, I'm going to sell it as I bought it. It confuses me too, but I got to tell you, Mary, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow you. Therefore also, that holy thing inside of you shall be called the Son of God. I must admit that when I read this text, I felt the angel was a bit insulting to say that the Son of God was a holy thing. How dare you call Jesus a holy thing? But then I began to sympathize with the angel, because the angel had never seen this before. He knew God. He had spent time in the presence of God. He knew man. He knew how man behaved. But he had never seen God and man in the same garment, wearing the same flesh. He said, I can't say man because there is God, but I can't say all of God because there is man. So the best way to describe him is a holy thing. It's a holy thing. Woo! Hallelujah. So ladies, the next time men watch you and thing, tell them I'm a holy. I'm a holy thing. Leave me alone. Don't touch me. No. Don't touch me. You see, if I was just woman, I would be seduced by you. But I have some God in me. You may not know what that is, but it's a holy. Every born again believer is a holy. That's why we sing songs of Zion and talk to a God we cannot see, because we live in a holy. So from today, yes, Gladys, holy thing. I'm a thing, but watch out, I'm holy. Watch how you touch me. I am holy. So when the Bible says God, have mercy. When the Bible says God became man, many of us don't understand what it took for God to become man. He did not become man in the garden before he sinned. He became man after 4,000 years of deterioration. I said after 4,000 years of deterioration. It would have already been humiliation if he had become man before man had sinned, because you're talking about Mr. Big. But he chose to become man when man had gone through 4,000 years of deterioration. That is not just humility, that's humiliation. God humbled himself. And I want to tell you that means to humble oneself simply means that God decided he will not use his divine capabilities to his own advantage. He will not summon his divine capacity to his aid and to his help. Instead, he humbled himself. At any time he was slapped, Jesus only had to say a word and the hand of the slapper would have been melted. But he humbled himself. High priest spat on him. Jesus could have caused this man to choke on his saliva. But he humbled himself. He took the whips and the beating. He didn't have to call 1,000 or 10,000 angels. He could have just said stop, and the whip would have melted. But he humbled himself. Are you with me, church? This is the humiliation. I'm talking about Mr. Big, who said, let there be, and there was. The very whip with which he was beaten, he made the raw material from which the whip came. The cross on which he died, Jesus made the tree. But he humbled. Help me, Jesus. He humbled himself. I want you to understand what this man did as he humbled himself. Anytime he could have retaliated, but when he was reviled, he reviled not, because he humbled himself. Imagine Jesus now being placed in a jury of unjust men. He could have wiped them out with just the sound of his voice. He could have just yawned, and the breath of his mouth would have been too much for them. But he humbled himself. I want you to understand that the story of the cross is not about what they did to him, it's what he allowed. You couldn't spit on him if he did not allow you to spit. But he humbled himself.
to take the blows as they ripped apart his flesh. But he humbled himself. This is my Jesus. Matthew chapter 27. Matthew 27 and verse 11. The Bible says, and Jesus stood before the governor, Pilate. And the governor asked him, art thou the king of the Jews? And Jesus said unto him, thou sayest. Verse 12, and when he was accused of the priests and elders, he answered nothing. Then said Pilate unto him, hearest thou not how many things they are witnessing against you? And you're saying nothing? And he answered him never a word, insomuch that the governor marveled greatly. You mean this guy not saying anything in his defense? What kind of man is this? I want to declare to you that even though Jesus was silent, light was shining. Because as a Christian, you don't always have to talk. People can know you're a Christian sometimes by your silence. Are you with me, church? Sometimes silence can say much more than when you speak. Jesus knew he was innocent. There was enough substantial evidence to exonerate him and free him from further interrogation. But he kept silent. Again, the message of the cross is not what they did. Is what he allowed them to do. Because you couldn't do it if I didn't come down here in the first place. I have learned that true humility is not about having a low self-esteem. Stay with me now. This is the part of the message I want you to get, if nothing else. True humility is not about saying, oh, no one knows the trouble I've seen. True humility is not accepting your limitations. No, that's part of it, but that's not all that humility entails. It's not about knowing that you can't do it. No. Humility is shown when you know you have the ability, but you step aside. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Knowing you have the power and authority, but you refuse to use it to your own advantage. Are you with me, church? It's easy for somebody to lay down their life when they know they have no choice. It's easy for you to surrender when you know you can't win. It's easy for you to shut up and be silent when you don't know the answer. It's easy for you to be abused when you know you can do nothing else. It's easy for you to give up when all the odds are stacked against you. But what if you are Mr. Big? No, you didn't hear what I just said. What if you are the God of the universe? The same God who said, let there be and there was. You have the power and authority to do anything. What if with you, nothing shall be impossible? You know you can do it. Humility, therefore, is willing to lose when you know you have all power. Oh, Lord, I wish this get down into your system. Humility is the willingness to surrender when your name is omnipotent. That's what humility is about. It's about giving up the fight when you know that you are right. That's what humility entails, is taking abuse when you could just say the word and your enemies will scatter. It's learning to remain silent when you know that you don't only have the answer, but you are the answer. Before Pilate, little did he know, was the silence of the Lamb. Answer not a word. Oh, what a savior to be whipped mercilessly and still say nothing. To be able to be mocked and chastised and accused wrongfully and still say nothing. I can imagine the angels in heaven. Father, just tell us, just let us go down. We'll fix them. That's our Jesus they're talking about. They're going to whip him. And the Father said, no, he must tread this wine press alone. Father, look what it's doing to the creator of heaven and earth. Leave him. It's when I see the travail of his soul, then I will be satisfied. crucified. Jesus was crucified, and he knew they had the wrong guy, but he said nothing. And he had all the evidence to prove that Barabbas was the man. But he said nothing. Instead of saying, "Father, why are you allowing this to happen to me?" He said, "Father, forgive. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." In effect, what Jesus was saying, let them continue to do what they are doing, because it's only when they do what they're doing that I can do what I came to do. I'm going to say that because you did not get what I just said. Let them continue to offer me up, because it's only when they offer me up that I can be the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Father, forgive them. What a savior.
Why was he so silent, I ask? It wasn't so much that Jesus was trying to pattern himself after a lamb. John declared in 1 John 1:29, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." Jesus therefore was not saying, okay, because John called me the Lamb of God, I therefore have to try to be like a lamb, so let me hush my mouth. No, it's the reverse. Jesus made the lamb to behave like him. No, some of you take it too long to get this. That's why, you see, everything God made that resembles him is because he is the pattern. That's why in John he is called the true vine. The thing that is crawling on the ground is only crawling like that because he is humble. So he made the vine to behave like him. Oh, Lord have mercy. He made bread. The way you make bread, he inspires you to make bread like that because he is bread. I am the living bread. Are you with me, church? So the lamb behaves like me. So the question, therefore, is why is Jesus the lamb a product of his own? Why is he silent? That's my question tonight. Why is he silent? It's a valid question. Because if the lamb was made to behave like him, then there's something he's trying to tell us by his silence. I wish to deposit at least 3 reasons into your conscience as to why Jesus was silent. The first reason is Jesus knew his accusers had already made up their minds. Oh, some of you will get this in a moment. Offering no amount of evidence or argument in his own defense would change their opinions of him. Are you with me, church? I have learned that when it comes to defending your own character and your own reputation, there are some people you don't take to court. Because no amount of evidence will change their opinions about you. Am I talking to anybody here? Are you being real here? Am I being real here? The truth is, if there are people who believe you are a waste of time, you can present all the arguments against it. They'll still say you are a waste of time. Do I have a witness here? If there's somebody here who has been told that you will never make it as a Christian, no amount of praying will change their opinions about you. You will never make it as a Christian. If there are people who say you will never change, then you will never change. If there are people who don't believe in you, they will never believe in you. I believe, and I've come to learn, that Satan never and will never like you. I said he will never like you. And he has some imps who feel the same way. And some of them walk to church. I want to be real with you. Some of them walk to church and you try to put on an image so they will like you. You try to do things that they will like you. Once they are working with Satan, they will never like you.
But I'm happy to tell you this evening that I am so glad that they don't have the final word on my life. I am happy that I serve a Jesus who has the final say. Go ahead and don't like me. Go ahead and despise me. Go ahead and shun me. My God says, you are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. And once God says and pronounces his opinion upon my life, then when the accusers come and the abusers come, then I reserve the right to remain silent. Hallelujah. I reserve the right. What they say, okay, that's all right. Let them talk, brother. Let them talk and say what they have to say. I didn't come to church because of you. I came because there is one Jesus. Sometimes you have to know when to shut up. Don't go about. I used to do it. You know, I used to do it. Don't try to present yourself. You can try to present yourself so that everybody will like you. Let me tell you something. Everybody won't like you. And even some of those who like you will stop liking you. Because there are people who are friends and then those who are fans. Once you are a fan, it means that once you're doing something good, I like you. The moment you messed up, I gone. But a friend sticks close than a brother. And a friend will love at all times. And the best friend to have is Jesus. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! The best friend to have is Jesus. So I have learned that it's not your opinion that matters. Your opinion is nice, but it doesn't count. And you must understand that, because even when people say good things about you, you still must not allow that to inflate your ego. Because sometimes people say nice things because they want nice things. You all know what I'm talking about. Some of you said it. Oh, you are the best this. And the it's because they want something. Mm-hmm. What you want? What you want? Be honest with me. What you want? That's why you ought not to allow praise or condemnation to get to your head. Because Jesus knows you better than you know yourself. Am I preaching this evening? Am I preaching this evening? Am I preaching this evening? The second reason, the first reason is that they made up their minds about Jesus. The second reason is that Jesus made up his mind too. So why should I defend myself? When just now I was in a garden and I told my father, not my will, but thy will be done. I made up my mind. So why am I trying to defend myself? Let's go to Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. Woo, Luke. Luke chapter 9. Are you still here? Are you still here? All right, Luke chapter 9, 51. The Bible says, Luke 9, 51. Mm-hmm. And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go Jerusalem. Verse 22. And he sent messengers before his face, and they went and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And they did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. He didn't come by us. He's going to Jerusalem. But he knows why he's going to Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? Because look at what they're doing to you, even as Elijah did. But he turned and rebuked them and said, you know not what manner of spirit you are. That man loves people. You got to understand how Jesus operates. Here's what he said in verse 56. For the Son of Man is not come to destroy. Is not come to destroy men's life, but to save them. So even if they did not receive me, I still love them. What a love! What a God! Because he made up his mind. He set his face. Let's go to John chapter 10. One more text on this. John, the 10th chapter. I'm going to read from verse 16. John 10, 16. The Bible says, and other sheep,
and other sheep I have, which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. Somebody say amen. Amen. Notice Jesus did not say other goats. He said other sheep. What's the point, Pastor? What's the point? Even though they're not attending church, you must not treat them as goats. Many of us only welcome people into the church because they look like they look like us. Are you with me, church? There are some people who may not like you, but they may be God's sheep. They got to treat them as God's sheep. So even though they behave like Samaritans, still love them in Jesus' name. There are other sheep. This guy is awesome. I don't want you to develop any animosity against my people. They are mine still. What about you? Before you came here, you were worthless like them too. You did your own wrong thing too. So what makes you think you're so holy? Because you're going to church? Come on, talk to me, somebody. Huh? You were in need of the same Savior that they need. So pray for them and work for them. I've come to tell you tonight that there is somebody here tonight who is another sheep. Come on, talk to me, somebody who is another sheep. Somebody is listening online, and though you are backslidden, God still sees you as his sheep. I said you are still his sheep. And because he made up his mind to save you, he will stop at nothing until you are saved. That's why he sent breaking news. 2013, he made up his mind to take the blows for me. He made up his mind to be rejected so that I can be accepted. He made up his mind to be despised so that I could be honored. He made up his mind to be hated by men so that I can know that I'm loved by God. Sometimes God puts you through an experience where the people who you love don't love you, because God wants you to know that when your mother and your father and your brother and your sister and your cousin and your friend forsake you, the Lord will take you up. Are you still loved? Jesus went through that. Even his best friend John wasn't there at the cross, but he still loved John. Oh, this Jesus. The old Negro spiritual said, didn't they crucify my Lord? Didn't they crucify my Lord? Well, they crucified King Jesus, and he never said a mumbling word. To utter any word in his own defense, get this, to utter any word in his defense in order to vindicate his character would deny Jesus the opportunity to be my Savior. Oh, you're ticking. You didn't hear that, so I'm going to say it again. Is it? To utter any word in his own defense is to deny him the right to be my Savior. I am told that shepherds consider it cruel to cut off the wool of sheep during winter. They will wait until the sheep is in springtime and summertime, because winter they need their clothes. So they won't shorn their wool during the winter time. But during the springtime into summer, it was the best time to do it. So Jesus died in springtime. But more than that, in order to get as much wool as you needed, the sheep has to stand still. Because you can cut pieces off that would not have the quality of shaving that is needed. So the sheep has to stand still for the shearer to cut. Bear in mind that every time the sheep is sheared, the wool is not for the sheep. Stay with me.
The wool is always for the shearer. But the sheep who understands that the wool is for the shearer tells the shearer, if I don't stand still, you won't get enough wool. I started to look at this practice. And I said, Jesus, you are the lamb. And you have to stand still so that they can get enough love. And enough mercy and enough compassion and enough grace. I am still and I'm keeping quiet to benefit you. What that tells me is that Jesus died even for the shearer. Jesus, though he was crucified, came to save those who crucified him. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You may not like to hear that, but even those who hated him and caused him to go on the cross, Jesus said, I die for you. Oh, God, what a savior. So I kept quiet so that you can benefit. Jesus. I said, Jesus, if I didn't keep quiet, you won't benefit. Get this. He has to keep quiet sometimes, because if he reacts the way he should react, some of us will be lost. Why do you think when you run away from church and start blaspheming the name of the Lord, you are still alive? Because Jesus kept quiet. You didn't hear what I just said. He kept silent. He saw how you raised up your voice against Christ and against Christianity. Some of you raised up your voice against his word, against his church, against his will, against his name, but he kept quiet. He did not retaliate. Why? Because somewhere I read, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, but is long-suffering, not willing that any of us should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Sometimes he keeps quiet so that you can be blessed. Oh, the greatest lesson I've learned from his silence is that sometimes Jesus is silent so that I can shout. He is silent so that I can shout. You see, when I think about the Lord, how he saved me and raised me and filled me with the Holy Ghost. Are you listening to me? How he picked me up and turned me around and planted my feet on solid ground. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, hallelujah. I don't know about you, but church, because of what the Lord has done for me, I can't keep quiet. I can't sit down as before. Don't start talking about Jesus. You get me too excited. It makes me want to It makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for you are worthy of all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. I can't keep quiet because he was already quiet. So now I can shout. Whew. Thank you, Jesus. Somehow David must have known this was going to happen. He must have known that when sinners are saved, he must have known that they were going to shout. So he penned Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye saints. Make a joyful noise. Because he knows, the psalmist David was a musician. And he would have heard everybody in church. And he would have known that not everybody could sing like them. Some of them want to be there, but they can't do it here. So he said, if you can't do it there, still come to church. But why? Why? Because you can make a joyful noise. You can make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Hallelujah. You're all making me want to preach. I didn't come here to preach. You're all making me preach tonight.
Go God is an awesome God. But I must begin to wind up and tell you the final reason. The final reason I want to deposit into your conscience as to why the lamb was silent is because Jesus is our substitute. And he wanted to exhibit the posture of sinners when you're convicted. Don't try to defend yourself. Because sin has no defense. So keep quiet. Don't be like Adam and say, the woman. Keep quiet. Many of us point our fingers, it's not my fault. The reason why this happened is them. Shut up. Keep quiet. You know what you did. And it's wrong. And even if it didn't do it, you thought about doing it. So some of you point your fingers at those who got caught. But the reason why you didn't get catch is because nobody caught you. Oh, I'm going to come down on the skin here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, come on, talk to me, somebody. So stop pointing your fingers and say, oh, that's the eldest child. Oh, that's so-and-so child. You too. And even if you didn't do it, you thought. And the reason why you're vexed she got pregnant is because she got pregnant with the man that you like. I'm being real tonight. Huh? So keep quiet. Be silent. Be silent. Sin has no defense. I said sin has no defense. But I can't leave you in hopelessness. Though sin has no defense, every sinner has an attorney. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Every sinner has an attorney. And the attorney says, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That's what the attorney said. Brother and sister, I don't wish that you fall down and sin. But if you sin, you have an attorney, an advocate, Jesus Christ, the righteous. I have an attorney, and because I have an attorney, I reserve the right to remain silent. I reserve the right to remain silent. You can throw your accusations. Talk to the attorney. I spoke to him last night. Speak to him. He is my attorney. And then he will step in and say, my truth shall be your shield and buckler. Don't worry. Don't try to defend yourself. Jesus will come and push me aside and say, now what do you have to say about my child? What? Oh, what did, yes, I know what he did last night. Yes, I heard what he did last night. In fact, I didn't hear it. I saw what he did last night, but perhaps you didn't read the script. Amazing grace. how sweet the sound that saved a wretch. He once was lost, but now he's found. He was blind, but now he sees. What do you have to say now? But I saw him. I saw him in the act. Watch him now. He's not looking the same. But the way he was last night, he's not looking the same. You know why he's not looking the same? Because the blood. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from, oh Lord have mercy, from all sin. That's why you can say what you want to say. I will keep quiet because my attorney will stand in my defense. Oh, what a love. What a love of God in giving himself to save this world. How can you walk out of here the way you walked in here? No greater love hath any man than Jesus
was willing to lay down his life. I want to appeal to somebody here tonight who needs to accept Jesus. Maybe you did it before, but tonight I'm going to appeal that you do it again. He is the only safety and security you have against the wiles of the enemy. He is your only refuge against his attacks and his accusations, and they will get more intense as we come to the end of time. God is my rock and my salvation. If you plant yourself on your rock of Christ Jesus, you shall not be moved. I said you will not be moved. Is there anybody who wants to say, Lord, I accept that love you have given to this world. You are speaking to me tonight. I want to say, Jesus, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Who is saying that tonight? If you are saying, Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee, stand to your feet. Whether you are at the sites, doesn't matter. You heard God's voice speaking to your heart. Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee.
Tonight, who's going to accept Jesus afresh? I'm going to ask you to come forward. I'm going to ask you to come forward. I'm going to ask you to come forward. You're accepting Jesus afresh tonight. Perhaps for the first time tonight. You say, Lord, because of what you have done, I can't help it. I must surrender. Thank you for remaining silent so that I can rejoice tonight. What a love, Lord. What a love. Somebody else. Somebody else. Somebody else. Lord, because of what you did tonight, because of what you did for me, not for anybody else, but Lord, for me, you would have done it for me, Lord. What a love. What a love, Lord. What a love. Somebody is accepting Jesus right now. Somebody else needs to accept Jesus tonight. Somebody else, somebody else. Again, again, afresh, afresh, afresh tonight. This is your start. This is your start tonight. This is your new start tonight. Come, Pastor Roberts. Pastor Roberts, I see you. Come, please. Pastor Roberts. What a love tonight. You died for me, Lord. I'm not going to miss this opportunity, Lord. I'm not going to miss this opportunity, Lord. I'm not going to miss this opportunity. Thank you, Jesus. If there's somebody else tonight, all I'm asking for you to accept the Lord. Nothing else. What a love, Lord. That's the reason why you're accepting him. Tonight, come wave your hands with me. Wave your hands with me. Thank you, Jesus. Wave your hands with me. Wave your hands with me. Wave your hands. What a love! What a love! Praise the Lord. Come on, sing it out. What a love. What a love. Praise the Lord. Come on, sing it one more time. Sing it again. Sing it again. What a love. Somebody else. Somebody else. Woo. Yeah. Oh, I need to sing it one more time. Come on, sing it one more time. One more time. One more time. We'll wait for somebody else to join us tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Every head is bowed. Those of you at the sites, you can bow with us, please. As we thank God for revealing himself tonight in such a marked way. And for those who have decided, this is going to be the beginning of the rest of my life with Jesus. Pastor.
Father in heaven, we have heard your word, Lord Jesus, and here hearts have responded with joy. We want to pledge you all our allegiance, and to your cause, Lord, we will employ. We thank you, Lord, that even today, the death that you paid so many years ago have still power. Mm-hmm. To save.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you that in 2013, your blood have still power.
Yes.
And as these souls surrender to you tonight, Lord, we pray that you would place a hedge around each and every one of them so that the devil will not get to them. Mm. We thank you, Lord, that even though you were wrongly accused,
yes,
you utter not a word.
Amen.
You did not exercise your power, but you have given that power to us.
Amen.
And tonight, we say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we pray that you would continue to empower your manservant, that as he preached your word from night to night, it would reach the hearts of the hearers, and many will surrender before it's too late. As we look at the world around us, we realize that God is being taken out of our schools.
I tell you.
God is being taken out of our homes.
Oh, Lord.
God is being taken out of politics. God is taken out of our government. But we thank you,
yes, Lord,
that they cannot take God out of our hearts.
Come on now. Amen. Amen.
And as these folks surrender tonight, seal them.
Yes, Jesus.
Not just for time, but for eternity.
Amen.
This is our humble asking.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 As you go back to your seats, thank God. God has done a good thing in your life. It's been a good walk in your life. For those of you who have cards, it'll be a good opportunity for you to fill out those cards while the praise team continues to sing. Good opportunity for you to fill out those cards. Fill out those cards.
See, what a love.
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 Pull it out before we leave.